John Carpenter on News Talk 1270 KIML.
News Talk 1270 KIML. Don Carpenter Show. And I think I got it right this time. I do believe on the phone we should have Governor Meade. Good morning, Governor.
Good morning, Don. How are you this morning?
Good. I'm doing pretty well, and I apologize. I had you in the wrong slot on my calendar, and I thought it was 9:05 and not 9:35. So I'll apologize to you personally, and you can send Rennie my apologies as well.
It's not a problem. You know, I just returned from Australia over there on a trip about coal, and so my time stretch is a little off myself, but I'm just glad to be on with you, and thanks for having me.
Well, and it's been a while, so tell us a little bit about the trip. We covered it when you left, but we really haven't heard a lot since you got back. How did the trip go?
Well, it was a great trip, and just a little bit of history on it. Wyoming and the previous administration worked with China and Australia on clean coal technology and how we can continue to advance coal and the use of coal for all the many years to come. And so this was my first trip on this project was 2 years ago, and that was in China. This one's Australia. The next one's going to be in Wyoming, where we'll have folks from China and Australia come to Wyoming for the same reason. It's about every 18 months or 2 years. And as part of this trip, of course, you have scientists from those two countries, and certainly Wyoming is a big leader in that as well, from the University of Wyoming, who are working on making sure that we have available the use of coal for the years to come. And as part of the trip, we were able to visit a port in Australia called the Gladstone Port, and it was pretty amazing the amount of coal that they currently are shipping out of Australia and the amount of coal they plan to ship out of Australia. They recognize, certainly at that port, the value of coal, not only to that country, but the world, as is the fastest-growing fuel source. And they recognize what it means to their economy, and they also recognize what it means to the economies of other worlds to be able to have an affordable, good fuel source like coal. And so I'm a little envious, as we in Wyoming have this great coal resource, and we're struggling to get out of our ports. And of course, Australia has an advantage because it's an island, and they have a lot more ports available to them on the states that produce the coal. So it was a great trip, and certainly I think pretty exciting in terms of what the science is doing in China and Australia and here in Wyoming and advancing the use of coal. So couldn't be more pleased with the progress that's been made, but recognize there's a lot to do still for us to get coal out of our ports and to make sure that we continue to advance the technology and innovation that's being done at the University of Wyoming.
Well, and of course, you're talking about the Pacific Northwest ports in Washington and Oregon. Has there been any progress made on that front at all?
Well, the companies working on those ports are making progress. The difficulty is, as you know, Don, is that those two states, the governors and the administrations in those two states and citizens have, I mean, not all, but certainly there's some objections to the use of coal, and it's based upon different reasons. One is they raise concerns about coal dust and other types of specific concerns, which I think the coal industry and the railroads and the state, we can all we can meet those objections and show what we're doing to make sure those aren't legitimate interests. I think they're mostly red herrings, but that's part of the education process. But the bigger concern is, for example, they are trying to do sort of this global standard where they look globally at the use of coal, and that is not the way the EIS is meant to be used. It's supposed to be used in a specific area for a specific project, and so they're certainly putting up some hurdles. But I think with persistence, with the good work of the private sector and what we can do in the state, that we will eventually get a significant amount of coal out of those ports.
Okay, and I guess it's just a matter of getting the word out, and it seems like, and every time I hear about this, it seems like another group has jumped on board. I mean, I think the last I heard, the longshoremen's unions were even on board because they understand that this is a lot of jobs for, you know, really really high paying jobs as well for longshoremen to, you know, load these ships full of coal. And I guess it's just a matter of time, hopefully, that, you know, before the people of the Pacific Northwest actually see the light on this.
Well, I hope that, you know, and that is my belief as well. And you're exactly right. I mean, when people see the jobs that it could provide and high paying jobs, I think it certainly makes sense for those areas to get on board with this. But on top of that, you know, I hope that there's a recognition that, you know, if you do not ship 1 ounce of coal out of Wyoming, out of those ports, coal is still going to be the fastest growing energy source in the world. It's a question whether or not Wyoming is going to participate. And what I would say is Wyoming should participate, number one, because we have such good quality coal. It's low sulfur coal, and it can be produced in an environmentally friendly and in a worker-safe way that may not be the case in every part of the world. And so whether or not we participate, coal is going to continue to be, as I said, a fuel source that is growing exponentially across the globe. And wouldn't we rather have Wyoming, United States coal used than coal from other parts of the world? For example, in Indonesia, which is a big coal producer, their coal is not the quality of our coal. And so this idea that you're going to not allow Wyoming coal out of the ports and somehow coal is not going to be part of the global energy portfolio is just false. The fact is it will continue to be a major portion of what the energy portfolio is globally. And so why not use Wyoming coal, which is better coal and could be produced in a better way than in many other parts of the world? So I hope they recognize that in addition to jobs and the economy, that it is something that is good globally because of the way we can responsibly produce it. On top of that is, you know, it's an interesting thing where you have over a billion people that have no electricity and another billion or so that are in energy poverty. You know, they're struggling to find ways to get running water and all that goes with electricity, to including, you know, how do you keep vaccines cool in areas where there's no electricity. And so it seems disingenuous to me to say, hey, we have sufficient power here, and so we're going to close off other people from having energy. So all those things I hope come into play and in the discussions and in the debate with the folks in Washington and Oregon.
Well, absolutely, and I want to shift gears a little bit, and of course the legislative session just ended, and we didn't get a chance to talk to you during the session. Oh, I almost stopped by your office while I was down in Cheyenne, but did you pretty much get everything you were expecting out of the budget?
Well, I thought it was a great session, and always stop in. The door's always open, so I'm sorry we missed you. But it was a very good session for us. I mean, you never get everything you want exactly, but in terms of the major items, we felt it was a very good session. I think that the legislature did a very good job looking at where we are today, recognizing that we have basically flatlined the budget. We've reduced the workforce. We've increased our savings, both in rainy day and in permanent savings. We've invested in infrastructure. And so this session was very good in the sense that it allowed us to look at the local funding, which it always continues to be a big issue for me, unified network in terms of broadband expansion, and an integrated test center that is going to help, again, on coal. It was a big deal. We worked on water development, game and fish funding, DD waivers. So I think it was an interesting session that it went, I think, very smoothly for the legislature. And I think it was a great investment in Wyoming's future and also a great investment in terms of where we are continuing to build our savings. So I think the legislature did a very good job in going over my budget. And, of course, as I said, not agreements on everything, but you never expect that. But we were very pleased about the session.
Well, yeah, and if you got everything you asked for, things might have been a little bit strange. So
right.
I guess if you know, if you get 80 or 90% of it, that's pretty good. The other issue, and I know you're probably kind of short on time, but I thought I'd ask about it, and whether, and I know there's, you know, some things that you might not be able to talk about with this, but of course with the Supreme Court's decision with the superintendent of public instruction I mean, has there been any kind of discussion on how that's going to be handled with, you know, with returning the powers to that office? I mean, has there been any kind of discussion on that so far?
Yeah, our office has met with the superintendent's office, and then just yesterday, the attorney general filed a briefing with the district court here, which I think, in my mind, will do all that it can to expedite the process to get the superintendent back over at the Department of Education. But I noted, even on an expedited fashion, the district court said, you know, even after the order, it may be, you know, 30 or 40 days before she's back in the department. And so, you know, it's what the process that was started by the superintendent in this lawsuit, now it's got to be finished through the district court. And so she's waiting for the district court, and we're waiting for the district court to make a decision upon the papers that have been filed by us. And then now the district court's waiting for a response from the superintendent's attorney, and the district court will look at that and make a decision. And I think in fairly short order, at least as you look at the docket and where you think it may be, she should be back over there.
Okay, it's one of those things with anything with government, it always takes a little bit of time, so it's just a matter of time.
Nobody in the executive or the legislative, we don't set the court schedule, either the Supreme Court or the district court. They it's their prerogative to address the case and address it on their time schedule, and so I can't affect that. The superintendent can't affect that. That's in the court's hands, and so we'll just see where the court goes on this.
Yeah, and I think anybody that's ever filed a lawsuit knows it doesn't happen overnight. So it certainly doesn't. And you know, courts, obviously, they have a lot of other things they have to get to as well. But I figured I'd ask about that. I know I've had a lot of callers kind of wondering what was going on with that. So I figured I'd check into it. But I guess are there any other things coming up for you? I know you've obviously you've announced that you're running for re-election. I mean, how's the campaign going so far?
Well, we did the announcement, Don, and thanks for asking. And now it's just trying to figure out in my mind how you know this is more than a full-time job, and I'm trying to figure out how to go about the campaign. And I, you know, what I say is priority one. I tell us that priority one, of course, is do the job you're elected to do. That's priority one. And do it as well as you can. And then secondly, the campaign is after that. You've got to do the job you're elected to do. And so I will do that and campaign as I can. But it's certainly not going to be the campaign that was when I first was elected, where I could spend most of my time campaigning. Instead, it's going to be the vast majority of the time doing the job I was elected to do, and then as I can campaign it. But I just won't be able to get to the same amount of campaign events or travel the roads like I did the first time, but certainly do my best.
Well, you know, it's kind of refreshing to hear that, because certain unnamed people in Washington have spent the past 5 years basically campaigning and not doing the job. So it is refreshing to hear that.
Yeah, you got to do the job you're elected to do, and then that's, as I said, that is priority one, and because it's before you go hunting for the next job, do the job you've agreed to and were elected for and a privilege to have, and do it as well as you can.
One final question for you, and this is, you know, I don't want to make look ahead or anything, but if you were reelected, what are going to be your priorities for the second term?
Well, you know, some of it's going to be continuing what we've done. The energy strategy that we came out with about a year and a half ago, I think is going to be critical. I mean, it's a great work product in my mind, and it's something we need to continue to work on, because we know how valuable energy is to our state and to our nation. And, energy corridors, water issues that go with energy, continuing to advance and promote coal, oil, gas, uranium, all of those things we've got to keep on. Secondly, of course, is infrastructure and local government. I just think government closest to people is where the rubber meets the road, and I'm going to continue to be a strong supporter of local government. And with regard to broadband, you know, in a rural state, you know, connectivity is a great equalizer, and we've made some great strides with the unified network, with what we see with tech companies coming into Wyoming. Certainly going to continue to press that if I manage to be reelected. And then there's the day-to-day challenges fighting, you know, the federal government from the EPA. Those seems to be daily challenges for us, and we're involved in a lot of litigation and battles, particularly with the EPA right now, and I think that will continue, and I think that's just an area where you have to be vigilant and continue to make sure you're being aggressive in defending the state's rights and the state's interests.
Well, and I'm pretty sure a lot of people listening right now will be glad to hear the state's rights, especially.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a state's rights guy, not only because that's my belief in the law and the Constitution, but it's also my belief in how this country can get up right on track again. Is you know, let the states run themselves, and if every state's able to do that, I think the country as a whole will be much better positioned.
Absolutely. I want to thank you, Governor, for calling in. And like you said, the door's open down there. The door's always open up here. Next time you're in Gillette, please stop by.
Thanks, Don, and thanks for having me on again. I appreciate it very much.
Thank you, Governor Mead, and hopefully we'll talk to you again sometime soon. And with that, we're actually out of time for the show today. That was Governor Matt Mead. I want to thank him for calling in. I want to, again, apologize publicly for having the appointment time wrong. I'll get it right next time. But we're out of time for the show today. I want to thank you all for listening today, and we'll see you tomorrow, 6 o'clock sharp. Stay tuned for Rush.
Your home for the best guests and local talk. Don Carpenter.
On News Talk 1270 KIML. 1270 KIML. 1270 KIML.